When it comes to decisions, of course, there's other important decisions in life. Things we have to think about. How much of it do we need? How can we make it really right? And how often do we need it? You, of course, all know what I'm talking about. It is food, it is sleep, and it is sex. And when we get it right, it makes us feel so much better. So these three things are things we're going to focus on the next 1.5 hours. And to set up the talk, we have a specialist here, Patricia Rickel. No, you're not a sex specialist. In a, oh, doch, doch, she says. Okay, good. but Patricia, to tell you briefly, I have to read it so I get it properly. I don't know. Patricia is the editor of Boda Style Group, which focuses, of course, on exclusive women's magazines since 2009. And she is the editor-in-chief of the wonderful Bunte magazine, a magazine that is read by up to 4 million readers a week, correct? And it's Germany's most popular people magazine, and she has definitely insights on people, on why they get together, and why they leave each other, most of the time, way too early, as she believes, and she's going to give us some insights from a people magazine's point of view. Patricia Rickel, come up on stage. And Patricia, oh. Two little housekeeping things. We have pushed the workshop on Die feine Art des Vögelns to 4 o'clock. And this is the one housekeeping thing, and the other? Ah, is that Patricia is going to talk in German. Is that okay for you? Please, if somebody sits next to you and doesn't get it, help us and translate, please.
Ah, das ist gut hier.
Oh, this is
for. Oh, das gefällt mir gut, Maria.
Welcome, Patricia Rickel. So.
Hallo, grüß Gott. Zuerst muss ich Ihnen mal sagen, dass diese DLD Woman ein wunderbare Fotos produziert. Und ich kann Ihnen schon sagen, dass in der nächsten Woche 2 Doppelseiten in Bunte erscheinen werden, weil einfach die Farben, die sie tragen und auch die Umgebung so großartig sind. Und als Chefredakteurin ist man froh, wenn man schon am Dienstag weiß, was man am nächsten Montag im Heft haben kann. Als Chefredakteurin der Bunten arbeite ich in einer Branche, die sich hauptsächlich um das schönste Thema der Welt dreht, um Liebe und um die Fragen, wer mit wem, warum und warum nicht mehr. Sie können mich als eine Art Gefühlssoziologin für prominente Beziehungen betrachten. Und ich stimme mit der Sexualtherapeutin Elia Bragagna überein. Ich, also Maria, ich bin auch Sextherapeutin, private. Dass das Problem zwischen Mann und Frau darin besteht, dass sie aus unterschiedlichen Gründen miteinander ins Bett gehen. Frauen machen Sex, weil sie Liebe wollen, und Männer haben erst Sex und finden darüber zur Liebe, gelegentlich jedenfalls, nicht immer. Mein Lieblingsfilm von Helmut Dietl trägt diesen wunderbaren Titel Vom Suchen und Finden der Liebe. Nach dem, was ich seit 40 Jahren im Promi-Sektor beobachte, müsste es eigentlich heißen, vom Suchen, Finden und Scheitern der Liebe. Denn obwohl ja lebenslange Liebe und Treue in unserer Kultur als ein erstrebenswertes Ideal gilt, schaffen das die wenigsten. Sie müssen nur mal nachgucken in der Rubrik Liebesgeflüster der Woche in Bunte. Und da können Sie das Auf und Ab der Promi-Beziehungen wie Wasserstandsmeldungen verfolgen. Ich gebe Ihnen mal einen Auszug aus der aktuellen Ausgabe, obwohl ich davon ausgehe, dass die meisten natürlich die Bunte gelesen haben, aber für die, die es nicht getan haben. George Clooney hat sich nach 2 Jahren von Stacey getrennt. Pamela Anderson kann nicht von ihrem Ex Rick lassen. Ashley Simpson wurde händchenhaltend mit dem Sohn von Soul-Legende Diana Ross gesichtet. Unser Tenniswunder Sabine Lisicki meldet Liebesaus mit ihrem Freund. Maren Gilzer trennt sich 3 Jahre nach der Hochzeit von ihrem Mann. Shakira streitet sich mit ihrem Ex ums Geld. Und Fürstin Charlene, 2 Jahre verheiratet, flirtet fremd mit einem Milliardär auf einer Yacht im Mittelmeer. Tja. Habe ich doch gehofft, ja? Bisschen Schwung hier reinbringen. Also, warum interessieren uns solche Nachrichten von Menschen, die wir nicht kennen und die Sie vielleicht auch gar nicht mal kennenlernen wollen? Der Hunger nach solchen trivialen Geschichten ist ungebremst. Jede Woche stürzen sich etwa 18 Millionen Deutsche, und davon sind etwa 90% Frauen, auf Magazinen und Zeitschriften, die sich mit dem Liebesleid und dem Liebesglück von Prominenten beschäftigen. Und in einer Zeit, in der die Printbranche schwächelt und die Auflagen sinken, zeigt sich der Markt Beziehungspresse, wie ich es gerne nenne, als ziemlich stabil. Und da steckt doch wohl mehr dahinter als die Gier nach Sensationen. Menschen brauchen für ihre Gefühlswelt eine Benchmark. Sie wollen sozial dominante Menschen beobachten, ihr Verhalten, ihre Mimik und Gestik studieren, um sich ihnen vielleicht anzugleichen. Und diese Storys über das Liebesleben berühmter Menschen, das ist eine Art Blaupause für das eigene Leben. Promi-Klatsch wirkt als sozialer Klebstoff. Und die Stars sind Stellvertreterfiguren, die wir anhimmeln oder auch verachten oder mit denen wir uns vergleichen wollen, um die Welt besser zu verstehen. Wenn Tina Turner am kommenden Wochenende mit 73 Jahren ihren langjährigen, 20 Jahre jüngeren Freund heiratet, kann man da selber auch Hoffnung haben, dass die eigene Beziehung vielleicht lange dauert und man im hohen Alter möglicherweise ein Liebes-Happy End erleben kann. Wenn Heidi Klum jedes Jahr ihre Hochzeit feiert und das 7-mal und sich dann doch mit großem Bohai von ihrem Ehemann Sil trennt, dann kann mir auch niemand vorwerfen, dass meine eigene Ehe nicht hält. Und ich bin dann keine Versagerin, denn Heidi Klum ist es ja auch nicht. Die Sehnsucht nach Liebe und nach einem glücklichen Eheleben ist universell. Doch die Realität sieht ganz anders aus. Die Geschichten in Bunte erzählen oft mehr von der wahren Liebe als von der wahren Liebe. Und das Wort Lebensabschnittspartner sagt eigentlich alles. Wir wissen, dass wir uns verändern, unvermeidlich, und uns auseinanderentwickeln. Und dabei wollen wir uns auch so eng wie möglich binden. Das Liebeskarussell, das Sie in Bunte jede Woche beobachten können und es bitte auch ab heute tun, dreht sich immer schneller und hektischer. Und wir selbst, wir sind in so einen Hamsterrad der Selbstoptimierung und Selbstdarstellung geraten. Ganz nach dem Motto, beim nächsten Mann wird alles ganz anders. Die israelische Soziologin Eva Illos erklärt in ihrem Buch, warum Liebe wehtut, dass Liebe inzwischen unter dem Gesichtspunkt des Investmentmanagements betrachtet wird. Was kriege ich, was fühle ich und was habe ich davon? Merken Sie was? Es geht immer nur um das Ich und selten um das Wir. Am Beginn einer Beziehung ist es ja völlig in Ordnung. Wenn wir uns neu verlieben, dann ist der Partner praktisch ein Spiegel für meine eigene Großartigkeit. Sozusagen liefert er mir ständig Standing Ovations und das ununterbrochen. Und das ist eine ziemlich eindimensionale Sicht, die sich verändert, wenn die Beziehung in die Jahre kommt. Und wir möglicherweise entdecken, dass der Partner Facetten hat, die nichts mit unserem eigenen Leben zu tun haben, die uns gar nicht gefallen, an die wir uns stören. Wir sind dann ein bisschen beleidigt, enttäuscht, vielleicht eingeschnappt. Es stellt sich so eine Ernüchterung ein. Und man könnte sagen, dass die Geschäftsgrundlage der Beziehung sich verändert. Und das ist genau der Punkt, an dem viele, viele Beziehungen scheitern. Ja, und auch Maria, der Sex erlahmt. Aber über Sex werden wir ansprechend, nein, ich meine das allgemein, aber über Sex werden wir anschließend gleich sprechen. Das wird dann hier Sie noch ein bisschen aufmuntern. Und ist es eine gute oder eine schlechte Nachricht, dass Männer und Frauen heute länger in Beziehungen leben, als unsere Vorfahren alt wurden? Was bedeutet das für eine Beziehung, wenn man 40, 50 oder gar 60 Jahre zusammenbleibt? Und wie verträgt sich das in einer langjährigen Beziehung? Der Anspruch auf Treue mit dem Wunsch nach lustbetontem Sex, so wie er uns heute überall empfohlen, vorgelebt, ja, und auch angeboten wird. Und überhaupt, mein Lebensthema als Journalistin: Wie schaffen wir es, in einer Wegwerfgesellschaft den Wert der Liebe zu erhalten? Liebe beginnt mit der Bereitschaft, loszulassen. Der schönste Trauspruch, den ich je gehört habe in einer armenischen Kirche, lautete: Ich wünsche mir, dass du so wirst, wie du sein willst, auch wenn dich das von mir wegführen sollte. In einer lebenslangen Beziehung geht es in meinen Augen um nichts Geringeres als um Erleuchtung, und zwar im buddhistischen Sinn. Keine Erwartungen, keine Ansprüche, keine Hoffnungen und deswegen auch keine Enttäuschungen. Das kann ein Reifungsprozess werden, der die besten Seiten in uns wachruft. Wertschätzung, Respekt, Hingabe, Loyalität, Fürsorge. Altmodische Begriffe, aber Begriffe, an die ich glaube. Und auch unser nächster Gast sagt, dass man in einer längeren Beziehung die Chance hat, aneinander zu wachsen. Und dazu gehört für sie aber, dass wir uns aus dem, wie sie sagt, kargen Sexualrepertoire unserer Vorfahren herausbewegen und Verantwortung für eine emotionale und sexuelle Lebendigkeit übernehmen und diese dann auch mit dem Partner teilen. Ich bin ziemlich neugierig, ob es auch ganz praktische Tipps gibt. Maria?
Ja.
Es geht weiter.
Patricia, this was an excellent, excellent lead-in to our next expert. Of course, you are an expert on sex too. I mean, I'm longing to hear your insights on that. And Elia Bragagna is coming to us from Austria, from Vienna. She's Italian, as the name says. And she's a physician that has specialized on sexual medicine yes. and psychosomatic, because she realized at some point that doctors have, we're not taught yeah. how to handle sexual problems,
yes.
especially with women,
yes.
right?
Yeah.
There is more knowledge about men with sexual yes, problems, yes. not for women. For instance, you said that doctors, when they have done hysterectomy yeah. on a woman, that might have affected her nerves, that she can't be
aroused anymore.
Or, yeah, nobody was taking care of that. Yeah, no one told her why she wasn't able to get an orgasm anymore, and things like that. Yeah. Or what happens to women when they take antidepressants. So Elia founded the Academy for Sexual Health in 2009, sees patients on a daily basis. And I want you to welcome with me our expert, Elia Bragagna.
Bragagna. Thank you.
Elia, you sit on the middle.
Wo?
Patricia?
Tu vuoi sol? Sol da her?
No. Nel centro.
Nel centro.
Nel centro. Elia, now that Patricia has so beautifully told us about the fact that after a certain time in a relationship which starts, of course, you know, with all that excitement and so on and so forth, there comes this kind of Ernüchterung. How would you call this in English?
Yeah, you see the partner as he is.
You see, you see the partner as he is. Giusto. Okay, and when you do this, when it suddenly you see the partner as he is, and suddenly sex obviously is as he is then, then people come to see you.
Yeah.
Okay, what do you tell them?
Patients came to me from different kind of reasons, or they have, they have diseases and therefore they have sexual dysfunctions, or they have sexual, they have relationship problems because they have sexual problems. Let's say that the woman, the main problem of all these, of the women, is desire disorders. They lose their desire. And then I have to handle with this topic.
So the couple comes and see you and says, he says my wife doesn't want to do it anymore, or she comes and says he wants me to do it more often than I want to. This is the way.
That is typical. This. She comes and says he wants more than I want. And what shall I do? I don't feel the need for it. And then I have to, it's strange. What I have to do first before I'm talking about that, I have to say, we are not talking about guilty, who is guilty. Because everyone who can fulfill all these norms, has the feeling he is guilty. He is guilty because it doesn't work. It isn't like we saw in all these papers and so on. So I say there, no one is guilty. We are looking for the cause, why they have the problem. And then we're looking for a solution for them both. Yeah. And then I'm talking to them, ask them, how would sexuality look like if there the problem wasn't here. And then I hear two different, very diverging version of sexuality, what she needs and he needs. And then I have a find.
Where are the biggest differences? What do men want, what do women want?
You can't say it generally. They are. It depends on the couple. For example, I had two bankers. He wanted every day sex, and she lost her desire. And she got depressed. And she said in front of our talk, that if I don't solve that, she will commit suicide.
Oh.
It was not stressing. Mm. And they diverged totally. Yeah. And I had to find out why do they act like they act. And then I realized that he needs sex to reduce stress. He has a stressy job. Yeah. He's the leader in a high position. And we had to find another solution for getting resolved from needs. Having sex every day because she's not his doll, his sex doll. And she had to learn to set limits. She was a foster child who didn't allow themselves to say no because she was afraid that they gave them back to this Waisenhaus. Yeah, she was
an orphanage.
Yeah. And so he learned he was a sporty man to do sport and just to get in contact with her if he really wants to be intimate. And that changes everything, because the contact were different, and she could change from duty to really needs. And for the first time, she realized that it's a sensual intercourse, not a job. For her, it was a job. And so we have to deal with each problem I have. That's the main topic is desire disorder. But we talked before in the lounge. No one wants to talk about that sexual desire disorder is the main problem from the young woman, not the old one. And that pain during intercourse is the problem of the young woman. They feel the need to have sex every day or whenever they want, this one night stand, and it's not that what they want.
Is it really a matter of quantity? Is it the problem that women just don't want to have sex as often as men? Because very often I hear it as well that women would like it more often than the men. Or is it something that a trap where we women run into is that we feel like we have to perform in sex certain way? What pressure are we under?
No, both are performers. When I talk to men, they're wondering, why don't my penis function? And I ask them, do you really have a desire for sex? They said, no, but it's possible now. The child is sleeping and I should use this time to have sex. And perhaps I'm a psychosomatic. I tell him, perhaps you should a little bit listen to your body. If your body says, I don't want to work, then please look why it doesn't want. Is it because it's not appropriate time, or perhaps you are tired and you should sleep? Or is it that you are the woman who's at your side is not the right one at the moment? Yeah. So the men have to change from actor, being an actor, and woman too. Yeah.
You told me this very beautiful example that you then, when a couple comes and they both say, actually, you know, the last time we had sex is a year ago.
Yeah.
And we would kind of like to find back into a sexual life as a couple. What do you teach them then to do? What are the exercises? I like this a lot.
Yeah, it depends. But what I told you, yeah, you won't do that alone, I think. This couple.
She won't do that?
No.
Why?
It depends. If she has a really big problem with the partner, yes, you will do that.
Now that you disclosed my problems, Patricia, let's talk about yours.
No. That's just for couples who really diverge because they had this big problem, and I have to keep them together to be close and with the bodies. Yeah, they are naked in a room and they are watching each other and caressing with each other, and for the first time, they realize how the partner really looks like. They
so don't. Slowly, you tell them. Sit down,
not
put
here.
Your clothes off, not here, at home.
At home.
Put a nice light on or put a spotlight on?
No, that's the first. We had always to ask the one who is afraid of being looked at. We look always at the one who is in need. We are not, because it's so. The society said you have to do it in this light. If you're really easy, then you have to do it with spots. It's a fake. Why should we? If she needs candlelight, she takes candlelight. If she needs the spots, she takes the spots. If she would like to do it on the front of the window because everyone wants to look at, then she will do that. Yeah.
So, okay, they got undressed, sat
then
in front of the window.
They are naked.
And now they look at each other.
Or caress each other. They touch. Before they do intercourse, they have to be in contact. And
so you tell them, this is what you to really look at each other.
To look at each
and
other.
And as well to look at the private parts.
That's what you want to hear. Yeah, but that's a special session.
I mean,
they have, because our society is so genital centered. They make oral sex. It's you have to do that if you want it or not. Majority said they don't want it. But you have to do that. You know, soft
to do what?
Oral sex.
Oral sex.
Yeah, you have to do that. It's your repertoire, you have to do that, yeah? But if you talk to them, no one looks at the genital. They make oral sex, and don't look. And in this session, at home, they look at the genital of each other, they present the genital, and what's typical, female look at themselves as aesthetic object, and men looked sensual. The
what?
Woman, sensual,
sensually.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Woman said, "Oh, my vulva doesn't look good," and so. But what does?
This is what you say. Then they come back to you and say, "Oh my God, but I look so terrible.
Ah,
my things
yeah.
are hanging. My belly's too
yeah,
so big.
Yes,
my
yes, yes, yeah, 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 yeah."
Okay. Now, but, what do you tell them?
Yeah, no. But what have a vulva to do with aesthetic? The function of a vulva is to attract the man, to eroticize him, to make him horny and everything else, yeah. And that's the function of vulva, not
just
being
beautiful.
Yeah,
but she comes and says, I feel ugly here or there and this, my cellulite, my so-and-so.
You know that it really changes if they allow themselves to feel instead of fulfill all these needs that is in the society. If they close their eyes and they are touched, that it changes. And if they listen to the partner, because this of the vulva story, I told you, I had one man really with tears in his eyes when he told about this vulva of his wife. He said, it looks like poppy. Like this poppy, these wonderful flowers.
Poppy flower.
And the man told me, each kind of flowers, from orchid to whatever, yeah, they really admire our vulva. But we don't see that because we had an aesthetic view.
When she sits in front of his her partner and says, yeah, but I feel so uncomfortable because this is ugly on me, this is not only the vulva, what would he then say?
Now, he would say something totally different. And that is what made a change. She allows herself to feel, okay, perhaps my breasts, if I'm up position, is not as ideal as I thought or when I was 18, but he loves it.
That's
it
what really they say in the men.
Yes, really.
This is your experience. That
yes,
the men that
I don't
say,
know how many hundred couples I had, but that's typically, perhaps I had one or two.
So what do they say?
They say, you feel good, you look good. It is, you make, no, whatever you make of my feelings, yeah? It's we have to change. Aesthetic has nothing to do with erotic.
Yeah, but
no one. Sorry, because if they go to the prostitute, do you think they have a catalog? What does it mean, catalog? Yeah, they don't have a catalog with the vulva or something. No, they go to them because they want to have a look at an erotic woman.
I mean, we can change as a woman. We can change a view of aesthetic, but can a man do also?
I told you they haven't the view.
Are you sure?
Yes, I am.
This is a crucial
thing.
That
is totally. Have a look.
Is this the reason why the old man
go for
young
women?
I think this has to do with totally. It's a different point. It's a different point. If we stop being with it, if we stop to live and being creative and what else, if we're stuck, then perhaps he will change and take another. Look, I don't know how many women are here with a young man. No one matters. I think it hasn't to do with that. No. And if you have such a man who wants you as an aesthetic object, then you have to think on your own. Why do I choose a man who's interested in me as an object, an aesthetic? That has only to do with me.
Yeah, yeah? But then you have few men.
Well, I'm sorry. I thought you were. we're running out of time, unfortunately. Yeah. Why don't you just prescribe to the couples a trip to the sex shop?
Yes. I do it. We have a wonderful sex shop, and we have a training course
in
Vienna.
Your center.
Yeah. No. In Vienna, we have a wonderful sex shops for women. Men can also go there, and I train my medical doctor, my physicians, how to handle with the topic erotic. They don't. They prescribe. They say, go and buy a vibrator. I don't know which one. So they go there and they.
You teach them what vibrator they should.
Yeah, yeah. Because if they say buy one, which one? For the clitoris, for the uterus. What
for
kind?
The uterus?
Yes, because.
I never heard of a vibrator for the
of
uterus.
Course. Of
Have
course.
You heard of a vibrator?
Yes.
Of course.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, because if there is a nerve, it's not nervus vagus, it's called, it bypasses the spinal cord and could arrange an orgasm. Yeah, and therefore, would have many vibrators for the urethra. Mm.
Okay, so we're having a little workshop
but
with Elia right after this on vibrators. How many different did you bring in?
No, but you could go to the sex shop, but you have to realize that if you use a vibrator two or twice, or I don't know how many times, it's also ritualized, and it won't bring back the kick. So if you want a kick, I think they all these couples you told, they are not looking for love, they are looking for kick. It's the love of infatuation, when they felt in love at the beginning, it's arranged by hormones, driven by hormones, and it changes to bonding. And bonding is a different kind of feeling. But that's what I told them. They could have and a sexuality that is as intense as in the beginning, because these bonding hormones, if you really get in touch with your partner, makes that in your brain, you switch on what we call subjective arousal, and it's as intensive as this kick sex. Yeah, not kick sex, thrill sex, we say in German, is kick sex, thrill sex. And so you have to look at the woman, what really makes that I feel bonded with my partner. It could be something different. It could be the style, it could be the love, it whatever. And if you're bonded, then you could change from love.
To, so there's many, many unanswered questions here. But Elia has a wonderful website you can visit. Can you tell us the name of the website?
www.afg. FSSG. Yeah.
With Elia Bragania, and the funny thing is, you teach things online that your son is not so happy about.
Yes, and
because I think it's very, you know, my son used to be very embarrassed about me kissing other men in movies, and it was, you know, is this another porn movie you're doing, mom? You know, because at some point I was kissing a man.
Yes, I have to
but
show
for
in
you,
one
it's
video.
Really, you like on one video, you work on a silicone penis and to show.
Yeah.
And so
my
what does your son
didn't
say?
Like it. And I wanted to show. No. There are so many therapy options for men, and I no one is talking about the one when you can give little taps you can give in the urethra when you are if you are having erectile dysfunction. And no one tells it to the man, so I show it in the video, and my son said, no, mama, that doesn't, I can't see that, but I have to show it.
So, thank you very much, Elia Bragania.
Thank you,
Patricia, for your wonderful
introduction.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.